Welcome to this year's Camp Meeting 2017. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of Him who hath called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. 1 Peter 2:9. May you all be blessed.
Algeria is one of the countries in Africa that I myself aware they have so much believe so much superstitions. There's a lot of witchcraft going on, voodoo and everything else in Algeria. That's why the Pentecostal movement is very, very popular in Algeria. People coming from all over the places when they announce that they're going to be a healing night. The pouring of the Holy Spirit. Man, they come in trucks. Line them up. Like, run them up, you know. They all come line up. And again, there are people. And this is one thing that I myself, I'm very, very shocked as I see that. And you look at, you know, from a view perspective as a human being, look at to another person, the person looks normal, like nothing wrong with it. You know, like in reality, you know, intellect, fine. But then when the whole thing rolled up, man, he's like possessed with something else. And there, it was this young lady that I was there. And again, probably you know all those details. I can just briefly give you in 5 minutes because we need to see videos. We need to see one particular video. And it's how we ourselves end up with the directors of the Pentecostal region. Okay? And right in the act, I said, I better record this to share to my brothers back home what's going on and what it is. And what it is now is totally a different person due to he's getting the gospel. You know, it's difficult sometimes, and it's critical sometimes. It's dangerous as well. In Algeria is what Boko Haram is. You familiar with the Boko Haram, right? The Boko Haram is these radicals who are determined to kill as much Christians as possible. They believe that kind of, in a way, the more Christians they kill, the more reward they're going to receive in heaven, or whatever they believe. So it's radicalism. So it was one of the things that's very difficult. So when they see a Christian, see the opportunity to be rewarded. By doing what? Kill him, cut his head off, or whatever the thing is. So Nigeria has been into all that. The new administration in Algeria, the government, the president of the present time in Algeria is an ex-military person. Then when he was a military guy, he was very restricted, very disciplined. So he's trying to implement the same theory, the same concept, and as a president, let me tell you, it's a different ballgame. So he's finding out about it. So, but he's determined to bring stability into the nation and bring again. This man is a Muslim, but is a Muslim with a different mindset towards Christianity. He said it publicly in this speech. He said, look, Christians and Muslims, they are need to be living in the nation looking as brothers of the Creator. I will not tolerate abuse. If a Christian abuses a Muslim, I will bring unto justice. As a Muslim disturbs a Christian, I will bring him into justice. I will stop this Boko Haram. And he's been fighting, negotiating. Maybe all those ladies been kidnapped, about 140, but they got back. They negotiated and they got back. I know no negotiation with terrorists, but they got back, right? But they don't know about it. In the negotiation, he already got the location where they are. So give me the girls, I'm going to bomb you tomorrow. So this is how it is. So when I was there in this little town called Boko, not Boko Haram, but ironically is the name Boko, about 140 miles away from a village that the Boko Haram destroyed, about 80 something plus people killed, decapitated, and so on, the whole village. And that area was not too far from we're trying to bring the gospel. You know, you want to bring the gospel when they're killing people, and I go to another different direction. But we're trying into it, and we ourselves determined to preach and teach the gospel. Then the Pentecostals, they are getting into the message. And I already given the story, probably some of you have been in the first time in the camp meeting. Did you guys ever hear the story how I ended up being connected with the Pentecostals? None of you? Okay, I'm going to give you briefly and I'll bring you to the pictures. I was to go into Nigeria to evaluate the work and to develop another plan of work to outreach program for the brothers locally and to put things in the right perspective to see where we are ourselves not as strong, where our weak parts, our weak spots, you know, and what we can do to improve it, and so on and so far, too, going forward with the gospel. I was doing that. We did the work, and we are about to be finished. Then notified me that as a family, they need counseling, and Abuja, which is now is the capital of Nigeria, before used to be Lagos. Now is Abuja. So we are going to have a meeting, but these two families need to be visited counseling, so I was going to be on Sunday. My flying out of Nigeria is on Monday morning. The thing was for me only to Sunday have an early morning with the Bible workers, have a meal in the morning together, and then after that, because of an issue with the bridge, the main bridge crossed from McCarthy to the main road going to Abuja, it was negotiating with the guerrillas there about charging money for the ones coming from the district money, the ones from the LSI. All right, got it. The problem, so they told him, look, it's a big line of cars in here, long line of cars. So we decided to go to another town, to another place, to a different way with our brother Daniel Terrence, one of the Bible workers there, and this ministry called Daily Manna Ministry of Steps to Life. In Nigeria. So we went into this place, we got a flat tire, and then the flat tire, we stopped. They said, no, come out of the car because they're not friendly to see a white person here. If they see one, they're going to go all crazy about it. So anyway, so they can't fix the car, they can't get it, so I got myself, what's going on? So I went out, sure enough, a motorcycle stopped, and they call, and pretty soon, the first I know, I was already in front of the Pentecostal church preaching in the morning at 10 o'clock on Sunday. On my way to Abuja, okay? And what happened, this man called his friend called the deacon called the elder called the pastor, and the pastor said, bring the American pastor to preach to us. I said, okay. And then when I show up on Sunday, 10 o'clock, it was quiet, the building. You can hear a pin drop. Maybe I said to myself, maybe they are praying. So I go very careful, quiet. As soon as I stick my big face on there, man, it's like whole world turned loose in there. Drums. There's no video. I'm sorry, I'm going to show you the video, but there's no video now. I had the video, but I cannot play the video. Man, it was African drums jumping and singing. There's about 900 people in this building inside. They're all dancing and making all the noises. I said to myself, wow. It's like you've been in the middle of the chaos, like, you know, like a Rio de Janeiro carnival in the middle of the last night and everybody goes crazy. It was something like that in there. And then the pastor said, that's for you. Welcome you. I said, okay. Thank you very much. So, and I said to myself, where am I going to be teaching these people? You know, I said, Lord. And then it came into my mind, just preach the word. Just preach the word. Okay, preach the word. And I said, Lord, I know the word, but what part of the word I need to be preaching? I said, I don't want to hurt nobody's feeling, you know? So the first thing to my mind, I start opening the scriptures. That was in John chapter 10, verse 16, where he's talking about God had many as who? As his sheep, what? And another fob is going to bring them all together to be what? And it's going to be one what? One pastor from all of the soil. I said, I believe, and I went into all that, right? That God has many of his sons and daughters scattered all over the world. Do you believe that? Amen, they said. And I believe that right here in Nigeria has many of his people. He's going to take it to the kingdom of heaven. Everybody say, praise the Lord. So I go into that topic. So I preached to them about it's going to be a judgment day. And what God is going to be using for the judgment day? Grace? What God's going to be using? I mean, I'm confused. Can please somebody help me? Had to be some kind of a protocols or laws. Remember, Pentecostals believe the nail to the cross. You can't say that, okay? So you need to be lit light up things that can bring back to you, okay? Please tell me what they're going to be using. And then they said, had to be some kind of a judgment. Had to be some kind of a law. You know what they're screaming all in there? I said, well, I'm confused then. We're under grace, are we? You know? And the people said, you know, everybody stop. Okay, let's get on to it. And I started getting into it very lightly, but I begin to just summarize the Ten Commandments, not from the one, from the 10, 9, and so on. Okay? But it's deal with what? Relationship to what? To one another. And I said, we start with that, then we can introduce Christ now. Because one of the 3 points of evangelism is to become first, become friend with a person. Okay? Second of all, then you introduce, okay, what your beliefs are. And third, introduce Christ to them. If you not become friends with a person, you have no room for introducing your beliefs and introduce Christ. But when the person become like you as a friend, then he trusts you. So that you need to be careful. Don't start talking about something that you are not established a friendship with a friend. The opposite. They don't know anything about what your beliefs are. So we're going to give you some, I see we come up with some pictures in here then, and we continue on. This young man name is Jack. This young man is 29 of age. This man is again as a Pentecostal. See, the movement of themselves, they're calling the Shepherd's Gate, okay, ministry of Pentecostals. And he's one of the plays very, very, is beginning to develop. And they are doing some fundraising, nice crusades, and all that to collect money to build what? The church. That's what they're doing it. So this young man is going to be his church. So as I'm continuing on, this is a congregation that he has. Okay? Now, just briefly, look into my time. I like to be where the time is. Look into my time. Bottom line, this has happened already about 3+ years ago. Okay? That developed. This is recently, but the connection. And how the pastor said to me after the first, the Lord orchestrated the visit. I didn't even ask for it. He just put him in and said, you're going to go there and preach the word of God. So that's the assignment for Sunday, then I'm ready. All right? So anyway, so what I was there, and I presented what I presented, and the pastor said to me, can you give us a week of prayer? I said to myself, well, I cannot commit to that. We need to pray. You pray about it, I pray about it, see what the Lord tells us. Okay. I come back, 3+ months, he called here in the ministry, want to talk to me. When I got the phone, he says, we've been praying for 3+ months, and the Lord spoke to us that you're going to come over here and give us a week of prayer. Just like that. I said, okay. I said, Lord, where are you? So I pray about it, right? So I said, sure enough, I went over. By then now, after the week of prayer, what I preached, the Ten Commandments. Every night, one commandment. Every night, one commandment for 10 days. And to the point, the last night, I got to summarize the thing. Okay, now we're going to look at then when Jesus died into the cross, what Jesus nailed into the cross. Then. There are two laws. Oh, two laws? What does it mean, the two laws? Yeah, they are ceremonial laws and moral laws. Do you want to know about it? They say amen. We'll get on to it. All right? So we got into the message. I explained the differences. And then when I explained it, use an illustration, and it went like this. We are wrong then. And the pastor right away said, I want to talk to you in my office. When we all finished, I said, okay, I guess it's the end of it, by the way. He said, Pastor, I was touched by the message. Nobody ever done this to us. And I know God sent you. God sent you here, and we are going to continue working. So the following year I came, I gave him more message. Now this time we agree, and before I leave, I'm going to give you some materials. we're going to study together. And next time we come, I want you to bring some points from all the things I'm going to give you. All right? All right. I came, and yet again, the following year, and I brought a set, the conflict series of Ellen G. White, okay, for each of the ministers. And then I purchased it myself, personally, the book they call Testimonies to Ministers, to each of the pastors. We're going to sit down. We're going to take 2 hours every day. We're going to all of us study. We're going to have open questions. And then the pictures. I know that they hear the pictures. But this is a young man. I have a translator in here next to me, one of the Bible workers of us, that he's telling me what's going on, what he's saying. And what this man's saying is here, I said, look, I'm just a young pastor here, but you know, said this pastor, said our pastor, our visitor pastor here from the U.S., he included me part of the pastoring, okay, staff. He says, he's been showing to me things I cannot reject. So I'm going to tell you that he's going to be preaching to you. He's going to tell you what it is. I already know it. And I am, myself, will be the first one to say yes into this message. But I want you to make that decision. So in the end, I've done that, present that, and it's right here. This is your man. Guess what I'm doing in here? Baptizing all the people from that church. This is the director. Like I said, we should have seen the video, but we had to wait the video. But you know what? It's Jack right here. Do you see Jack right here? Jack is there. Well, it's because of the way of the pictures. But he's taking the video, and he's ready. So he went into the water as well, Jack. He's bringing all each of those members of this church. There he is, Jack, again. You can see it clearly now. Is there the whole church surrendered themselves to be a SDA. Now that, who's helping me? The director, okay? Like he told me. This year, you ready for this? Because of the time. I cannot show you any more pictures. It's very exciting. I'm going to go quickly than you want, and I can wrap it up in the few minutes that I have. This man in particular is cramming. This man was a heavy load, and his heart has been bad. Stealing, robbing, lying, abusing people, whatever you think is the worst thing you can do, you name it. He's done that, been there. But when he was there, since I've been coming, he's been watching every single thing, and when I, the final, he was right there with Jack, make the decision. When he come out of the water, he says, praise the Lord. He said, I'm a newborn person. I will not look back what I've done. I'm going to do now what the Lord is telling me to do. It was this man, it was screaming, like, you know, a person like he's been, I don't know, like, let's say an example, win the lotto, whatever the thing is. He was so happy. So happy, this man. Even this, the pastor was looking at the man, what is wrong with this man? Whatever he's eating and acting, I want some of that, probably he was saying it there. But he was so happy because of that. And then this is another section in another church that took place again. All the results that we are studying individually for those pastors. Okay? For the pastor. He's right here helping me, baptizing all of them, assisting me. This is the church that was the other place that we went over and do it. But I'm going to go fast because of the time, and I'm sorry that I had to go through it to explain that to you. At this time, this is how it is in Nigeria. It's two sections of the country, or two districts, if you want to call them, or two conference divisions of the Pentecostals. One is in the east of Nigeria, the other is in the west Nigeria. And the one that I'm right there in Boko area, with McCarty, we have all together, all the pastors, 2,700 people. Okay? And the other side that we're working is 3,200 people. This year, God is helping us to orchestrate the big event in Nigeria ever. Where? In the stadium of Boko. All, close to 8,000 people coming to hear the message. All Pentecostals. So we already approved. We already agree. They are negotiating the time. you know, all the logistics and all the things you need to go through it, we're going to do for the first time ever in the congregation as an independent people, brothers, with a congregation of 7,000 to 8,000 people in the stadium. I know somebody else is looking, but I say, wait a minute. If this ministry can do it, why we are not been doing it, right? If you're doing God's will, you're doing God's will, and you're doing the work of the Lord, and you are yourself prepared for the assignment, God can do wonders. You're another one. And I always said to the people, no bless them, no give thanks to the messenger, honor the messenger, give it honor and glory to God. That's my responsibility to do that. So all the recognition is to the one who died and paid the price for you and me. So this is Nigeria. I cannot show you what's going on in the Philippines. A tremendous work in the Philippines. Philippines, you know, is one of the countries that are very Catholics. And Metro Manila. We'll do some other time. So many thousands of people there, we're doing the same thing. I said, the result of very faithful young people determined to do God's work, the Lord can. Turns around. Then we have this movement growing rapidly as well in Zambia, Malawi. Talking about massive people, thousands of people. When we started in Zambia, Malawi, I think somebody can correct me in this if I say numbers wrong. Zambia, Malawi, we started about around 5.5 years ago, working with them. And we started with 43 people. And Lusaka, the capital of Zambia. And one person is Henry Moesa, was willing to work. Right now, Zambia, we right now working all the logistics, and I helping as many helping in all the rest of the countries, to do all the legal paperwork, to do all the protocols, you need to go to the government because all regulations everywhere now. To establish a division they call Zambia Malawi Division of Free Seventh-day Adventists. All together, from Zambia Malawi, 23 churches now. Everything's in 1,000, the numbers. It's the result of faithful, dedicated people. That's why Pastor Yamon mentioned earlier, I said, well, the Lord told us that you love the Lord and you are in this, you better be a what? Do something, be a missionary, do something. That's for the honor and glory of God. So this is what we are doing. I know when you look at about the United States has 352 plus million people. And you look at all the millions of people around the world, it's like a drop of water in the bucket, right? But you know what? If that drop of water is not in the bucket is empty, right? It make a difference, right? But see, the thing is, the matter is, God is going to take into heaven quality, not quantity. And we are shooting for that. To shoot for the quality that God's going to take into heaven. Everybody wants numbers. Everybody wants massive things. We're looking for quality. I know that this big event, mega event ever that the Adventist, the independent movement is doing it, is still going to take place in Nigeria. I know it is big numbers, but you know what? I'm not worried about it or be discouraged about it. Out of those, maybe three people. The important is that we done what the Lord says. You give the message at their choice, their decision. So we are doing that. We done that, and we pray to God that even would be 10 or 20 people or 5 people, it was worth it to give the message and the time they were living in. And this country is so chaos in terms of doctrines, cultural things, about the farce of that, all the things about practice. Let me tell you, I have a minute or so. Let me tell you this. When you find out Nigeria, you go and you find out the way they're eating such a horrible things on there, but see, this is the culture. Like driving in the road in the dry season, okay? And they have people there, like, you know, radically, what is a hot dog? Rat and what? Rat and the stick is what they call him. I call him that, the hot dog today. It's a rat and the stick. Well, reality, and the road where you're driving, in the dry season, the people have rat and the sticks like that for sale. Because what they do, It's a dry season. The rats trying to get something. They go into the holes. They throw fire on it. They burn it. And they come out. They all halfway roasted. Put them in the stick. And the people says delicacy. They eat it like caviar. You eat caviar. People say, what is this? This is fake. You know, fish eggs. I mean, come on. But anyway, and the people that grasshoppers and all kinds of weird things. That you, and the people eating that. So when you give the message, they even just things look like a 737 planes, but there's a little ants type of thing, kind of a weight of a family of termites, okay, but the kind of a forest termites are big. They have bigger wings and all that, and they come and it's just by abundance, right? But what the people do, they catch them, they cut the wings, they roast them like a making popcorn, you know what I mean? But kind of a roasted, and you put them on a handful in the mouth. This is the, and the pastor one time, this one I was talking about, and there, one time I was right there to sit down. It was, you know, it was getting dark. He said, Pastor, try this of the good. I said, no, thank you. He said, no, thank you. So, but see, I said, brother, if I eat this, one thing, I will get sick. You don't want me sick, do you? I said, no. And I said, look, I know that the Lord doesn't want me to eat that. So you don't understand now, but eventually you will. But go ahead, you carry on. Carry on. And you can see them when you put it in the mouth, the crunching inside. You know, I had to be, you know, make no faces and look at him, you know, stay calm. You know what I mean? Stay calm. Because remember, you are in this territory, okay? You need to be friends with the brothers. Because of that, and he told me one time, you know, Pastor, I like you kind. I like that you're sweet. You know, say anything. All you bring us and your message is Christ. Get ready, he's coming. And you're bringing us the evidence. You never say about this denomination or this and that, nothing. And that's why the people like you, the why it's open up for you to come to this big event. You're going to be the one. And he said that to me. I already make my decision that I will follow what is right. So pray for us. You know, it's this big event. The devil can throw a monkey wrench in this. You know that? Can really disrupt things, make things happen, and say, you know what? It's not going to happen. I'm not worried about it. I'm just waiting for the call to say, we are ready. And when they're ready, I'll be there. So I need your prayers. We need your prayers. Steps to Life is committed to do that. Go to those places, get things going. The Lord is coming. We need to use the freedom that we have right now. We need to have the resources that we have right now. We're not going to be able to buy and sell. We're not able to go. We're going to be what? Or the leash, right? You're going nowhere. But until then, and now, there's still room. We have to keep going. The Lord says, be occupied into what? Till I come. So we need to be busy. This is our responsibility. We need to go and face whatever in the name of the Lord. Amen? So we need your prayers to guide us and direct us. That when you pray, the Lord will tell us which way to go, how we get it done. Because they are very sincere people among this big congregation. The Lord knows where are those persons. But let's pray that the persons at that time, at that event, they will be there to make that decision. So I hope that encouraged you that we are doing something. Maybe you're not there physically, but you know, your prayers and your support, we're all working together. Amen? So let us kneel together to have this event will take place. Oh, precious, lovely Heavenly Father, Lord, we are not worthy, Father, for such a opportunity, such assignment, and such a mission. But Lord, you know the hearts of each one of us, the intentions, the motives, and the love, and the dedication, and the willingness. And please, Lord, guide us in a way that wherever we need to go, in faith, we go. And in faith, we move. And trusting in you, we will present what we need to present. I pray, Heavenly Father, that this event will go according to thy will. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that this event will take place at the right time and the right moment for many of them that will make the decision to be part of your family, my family, and the family of all of us. And this faith. In Jesus we pray, we ask, and we thank you for this opportunity able to share this with my brothers and sisters, this mission report. In Jesus we thank you, and in Jesus we ask. Amen.
We hope that you have been blessed by this sermon. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may also call us at 316-788-5559. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God bless you.